Every now and then, seeking to rid my mind of thoughts of death and doom, I get up early and go down to Fulton Fish Market. I usually arrive around 5:30 and take a walk through the two huge open-fronted market sheds, the old market and the new market, whose fronts rest on South Street and whose backs rest on piles in the East River. At that time, a little while before the trading begins, the stands in the sheds are heaped high and spilling over with 40 to 60 kinds of finfish and shellfish from the East Coast, the West Coast, the Gulf Coast, and half a dozen foreign countries. The smoky riverbank dawn, the racket the fishmongers make, the seaweedy smell, and the sight of this plentifulness always give me a feeling of well-being, and sometimes they elate me. I wander among the stands for an hour or so. Then I go into a cheerful market restaurant named Sloppy Louie's and eat a big, inexpensive, invigorating breakfast, a kippered herring and scrambled eggs, or a shad roe omelet, or split sea scallops and bacon, or some other breakfast specialty of the place. Sloppy Louie's occupies the ground floor of an old building at 92 South Street, diagonally across the street from the sheds. This building faces the river and looks out on the slip between the Fulton Street Fish Pier and the old Puerto Rico Line dock. It is 6 floors high, and it has 2 windows to the floor. Like the majority of the older buildings in the Market District, it is made of hand-molded Hudson River brick, a rosy pink and relatively narrow kind that used to be turned out in Haverstraw and other kiln towns on the Hudson and sent down to the city in barges. It has an ornamented tin cornice and a slate-covered mansard roof. It is one of those handsome, symmetrical, old East River waterfront buildings that have been allowed to dilapidate. The windows of its 4 upper floors have been boarded over for many years. A rain pipe that runs down the front of it is riddled with rust holes, and there are gaps here and there on its mansard where the slates have slipped off. In the afternoons, after 2 or 3, when the trading is over and the stands begin to close, some of the slimy, overfed gulls that scavenge in the market roost along its cornice, hunched up and gazing downward. What's up, party people, and welcome back to another episode of NYC Foodways, your weekly food and culture discussion from the cultural capital of the world. My name is John, and this week's episode is dedicated to my best friend Gabe out there in California. Your single-minded determination is the hallmark of any successful man. This week on NYC Foodways, we bring you part 2 of our series on your favorite chronicler's favorite chronicler, Joseph Mitchell. Today's topic is the essay Up in the Old Hotel. Originally published in The New Yorker in 1952, Up in the Old Hotel is not only a magnificent piece of writing, but also the name of the omnibus edition of Mitchell's work, the text this entire series is drawn from. The setting of Up in the Old Hotel is the Fulton Fish Market, a historic marketplace that, like so much of old New York, is unfortunately no longer in operation, a fact that would likely mortify Mitchell were he still here with us. On paper, Up in the Old Hotel is about the defunct floors above a waterfront restaurant, but like everything in New York, there's much more to the story. Louis Marino, owner of Sloppy Louie's restaurant and the protagonist of this story, is another classic New York character brought vividly to life through Mitchell's razor-sharp narration, an American dream type made flesh who left an uncertain economic future in northern Italy for the nebulous promise of plenty in the Big Apple. Marino became the proprietor of his own place after decades as a waiter around town, where it should be noted that his hours were 10 a.m. to 9 p.m. His tenure waiting tables brought him in close proximity with many of the city's highbrow dowagers, and through them, Marino's innate curiosity and amiable nature eventually turned him into an amateur ethnographer of some of the city's most old and powerful families. Elegantly, in purchasing the restaurant that became his namesake, Marino's own narrative became intertwined with the same families he used to rub shoulders with as a waiter. Marino chose to stake his claim at the Fulton Fish Market for good reason. Thousands of miles away from his hometown of Recco, Italy, here he feels at home. He states, "Fulton Fish Market reminds me of Recco. There's a world of difference between them. At the same time, they're very much alike." Let us turn now to Sloppy Louie's itself, an institution beloved by Mitchell for its wide-ranging fare. Mitchell claims, not without merit, that in the course of a year, Louie's undoubtedly serves a wider variety of seafood than any other restaurant in the country. Many of us go out to restaurants and bars as much for the clientele and the energy of the establishments as we do for the food itself, and Mitchell is no different. Mitchell favors Sloppy Louie's, or at least focuses on it, as much for its clientele as its food. Like many of my own favorite restaurants in New York, Louie's attracts patrons from across the middle and lower sections of our fair city's class structure.
Working people go for the convenience and price. Recall that this is a market restaurant directly adjacent to many people's place of work, not to mention the cooking. While people whose incomes afford them the latitude to choose where to dine flock to Sloppy Louis for its diverse menu and high-quality preparation. Contemporary restaurants in the mold of Louis include Wu's Wonton King on the Lower East Side, Kanji Village on Allen Street, the recently deceased La Caridad 78 on the Upper West Side, and I Am Star Cafe on Division Street. Like Louis, all of these places sport extensive menus, extremely high-quality cooking, prices suited to working people, and a complete lack of pretension. But Sloppy Louis is absolutely not the place for everyone. A bona fide Knickerbocker blue blood makes an appearance at one point, turning her nose up at the restaurant and retreating back into her chauffeured limousine. Which is just as well. The New York City restaurant milieu is full of places frequented by her ilk, few of which I find to be of any particular culinary merit. Neither Louis Marino nor Joseph Mitchell are native New Yorkers, but they are as much New Yorkers as anyone else, including myself, as I can imagine, and the intersection of their paths speaks to the absolute best parts of living here. Only in New York could two people from such different backgrounds become friends. This unlikely connection, and the innumerable other connections that make up New York, is what, ultimately, Up in the Old Hotel is about. The relationships between food, diner, restaurant, industry, owner, building, neighborhood, and city. The convergence of people with wildly different economic, cultural, demographic, and migratory histories. Sloppy Louis restaurant is an apt metaphor for New York itself. A common ground and melting pot, with people jammed up beside each other, some by choice, others compelled by economic circumstances. And this confluence of currents that Mitchell so deftly weaves together is what makes New York such a beautiful, compelling, and at times difficult place to live. May New York City never cease to attract newcomers. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next week for another episode of NYC Foodways. Peace.